Hello, welcome to Byte Size. Today's question is, why are floppy cables twisted?
It's the age-old question, a question that has been boggling mankind for decades. Why do floppy ribbon cables contain a twist? Now, I've wondered this from the moment I first opened my PC to reveal its glorious contents. It looks like a hack, something wasn't quite right in the design, but was fixed by reversing a few wires. And this is, essentially, accurate. Modern systems generally lack our beloved A-drive, that magical slot which brought such a wide variety of sound and volatility to proceedings. But go back a couple of decades and these devices were completely essential. During the 1990s, they were commonly connected directly to the motherboard, much like your hard drive, and with a cable very much reminiscent to your hard drive's IDE connector. However, whereas an IDE cable has 40 wires, the floppy cable only has 34. Much like an IDE cable, a floppy ribbon usually has multiple connectors. For IDE devices, these were used to connect up to two drives, which could then be denoted as a slave drive or a master drive, allowing two hard drives, or a hard drive and CD drive, to be linked to a single IDE channel. Traditional floppy cables would have five connections, one to attach to the motherboard, with two for the A drive depending on whether it's a 5¼-inch drive which used card edge connections, or a 3½-inch which used pin header connections, and two connections for the B drive. In later systems, the 5¼-inch connectors were usually negated, as was sometimes the B drive connection, meaning a cable could just have the drive and the motherboard connector. So that's all good and dandy, but what about this little twist? To answer this, we have to go back to the birth of floppy drives, in an IBM PC compatible sense at least. And as usual, we begin with the IBM 5150. Back at the start, floppy drives relied on a drive select jumper to determine which drive was A and which drive was B. These jumpers required setting, even if there was only one floppy unit in the system. With two drives installed in the system, this was essential so that the single floppy header could determine which drive it was talking to on the single cable. If you wanted to install a new drive in your single drive system, then you'd have to make sure the jumpers were set correctly on each drive so that the system could differentiate between them. Likewise, if you wanted to remove a floppy, you'd have to remove the one set up as drive B or swap the jumper settings over. Now this doesn't sound like much of a chore, but IBM realised that it was a pain swapping jumpers around, especially when dealing with mainframes and larger systems. Their solution for this was to set up every floppy drive to be a B drive as standard, and instead rely on the cable to determine which is which. The twist falls across wires 10 to 16. Wires 11, 13 and 15 are ground wires which carry no signals. However, wire 10 and 16 are the motor enable wires for drives A and B respectively, whilst 12 and 14 are drive select B and A respectively. Therefore, by inverting these wires, any drive after the twist automatically becomes the A drive, and the drive before the twist remains as the B drive. So rather than messing around with jumpers, you simply plug the last connector into the floppy you wanted as A, and the other connector would plug into B. The other wires carrying the data and head select routines would then only apply to which drive was selected by the floppy controller, as an unselected drive simply ignores the input. Now, for a while, some systems actually retained the jumper approach or even actually tried their own hack, such as twisting the signals on the motherboard rather than the cable, but this just caused confusion, especially where twisted cable was also used, and the IBM standard was eventually adopted by everyone. It's quite a simple hack, which although giving the ribbon cable an afterthought-like appearance, it works beautifully and saves us from losing all those plastic jumper connections under our desks for the rest of eternity. So what about our IDE cables and hard drives? Well, there was actually a cable select protocol which used the exact same idea. To use it, both devices needed to be set up for cable select, ironically through the use of a jumper. And then through the use of a specific cable, wire 28 is only connected to the master drive. This means that in this instance, the master drive needs to be in the middle connector and the slave drive the in connector, the opposite of our floppy setup. Now, this inconsistent implementation was one reason it never really caught on, unlike our simple but beloved floppy cable twist. Strangely, there are also cables which do the twist before the first connector and then twist again for the second drive. This requires drive A to be placed in the middle connector, and appears to have been made to fit certain restrictive case designs, because other than that, it's rather bizarre, to say the least.